teaching about the topic laryngeal obstruction. This topic is for BSc third year. And this is from the first unit. So let's go with the introduction. Let us see what larynx is all about. So larynx, like I said, larynx is a, it's like a voice, it is a voice box, okay? Or it is a stiff box that will not stretch. It contains a narrow space between the vocal cords through which the air must pass. So larynx is basically like a voice box, okay? And it has, there is a narrow space which lies in between the two vocal cords, and that is the place where, or it is a passage where the air will flow from the environment to the lungs. So that is the function of the larynx. So if there's any obstruction in the larynx, then we call it as, or if there's any blockage in the larynx, then we call it as laryngeal obstruction. Obstruction of the larynx is because of edema, if there's any swelling in the larynx, or it is very serious, it is often fatal condition. Swelling of the laryngeal mucous membrane may close off the opening tightly. Okay, so like I said, that there is an opening between the two vocal cords which the air will pass through. So if that narrow opening is closed, okay, or because of the edema, because of the swelling of the laryngeal mucous membrane, that opening is closed, then, or it is tight, therefore patient, therefore the air will not pass easily from the environment to the lungs, or from the lungs to the environment. So patient will be having suffocation, and this leads to a life-threatening hypoxia or suffocation. That's why, since air will not be able to enter to our lungs, so patient will be having suffocating and hypoxia, lack of oxygen in the blood. So that is about laryngeal obstruction. Okay. So let us see what is acute laryngeal edema. Okay, if there's any edema formation on the larynx with inflammation, injury characterized by hoarseness or dyspnea. Dyspnea is difficulty in breathing. It is managed by tracheostomy and epinephrine 1:1000. Okay, so what is acute laryngeal edema? It is basically edema in the larynx. When this larynx it is being inflamed and infected with microorganisms, then there will be edema or swelling in the larynx, and this can cause laryngeal obstruction. Next, laryngeal spasm. Any spasm of laryngeal muscle occurs after administration of general anesthesia. Spasm means contractions kind of. Okay, so there is contraction of the laryngeal muscle, and it occurs mostly after administration of general anesthesia or any traumatic attempt at endotracheal intubation. When we when we perform the endotracheal ETT tube intubation, even in such cases also there can be chances that the larynx will be there will be spasm in the laryngeal muscle. Okay, so this is managed by establishing airway, oxygen, neurotransmitters, blocking agents like succinylcholine. So this is the management for laryngeal spasm or laryngospasm. So these are the two things or two causing factors which causes laryngeal obstruction. Next, laryngeal paralysis. Paralysis, we know that there is no function or no sensation. Therefore, loss of sensation which results of neck surgery or tumor, then we call it as laryngeal paralysis. Okay, meaning that the larynx, it is not, there is no sensation in the larynx, okay, and there is no functioning of the larynx, it is paralyzed. So that is because of any neck surgery or any tumor which is present in the larynx. Next, laryngeal injury. It is often result from trauma during motor vehicle accident. So if there's any car accident or motorcycle accident, okay, because of this, patient will have laryngeal injury or trauma. Therefore, this can also lead to laryngeal obstruction. So these four: acute laryngeal edema, laryngeal spasm, laryngeal paralysis, and laryngeal injury. These are the common factors or common causes for laryngeal obstruction. Next, the causes are hereditary, valve disorders, okay, the vocal cords, okay, so if there is any, tightening or any injury or any trauma to it, then it can cause this laryngeal obstruction. Thoracic surgery, okay, any surgery to the thoracic cavity that can lead to laryngeal obstruction. Now coming to the clinical features. So like I said, that patient will be having suffocation, not able to breathe properly. Okay, so some of the clinical features are as follows: hoarseness of voice, dyspnea, that is difficulty in breathing, aspiration of food or saliva, neck swelling, inability to speak because the vocal cords are affected. Okay, there is tightening of the vocal cords, so the patient will not be able to speak properly, and a patient will have cough. Okay, so these are some of the signs and symptoms of laryngeal obstruction. Now coming to the management, a thorough history is very useful in diagnosing and treating the patient with laryngeal obstruction. Therefore, history should be taken, past history, present history. Okay, any previous surgeries have been performed in the patient, that also should be noted. Next, we have to maintain the airway, okay, by giving mechanical ventilation or endotracheal tube intubation. Avoid heavy alcohol or tobacco consumption. Avoid current medication, history of airway problems, recent infection, pain or fever, dental pain or poor dentition, or any previous surgeries, radiation therapy or trauma. So these things should be avoided. Next, patients with nasogastric tubes in place will develop a post-cricoid ulceration, which is called as nasogastric tube syndrome. This ulceration will affect the posterior cricoarytenoid muscles, which causes the vocal cord abduction or paralysis, and ultimately it causes airway obstruction. So this nasogastric tube syndrome also is, we have to check the history of patients with nasogastric tubes. Okay, with NG tubes also we have to check for the laryngeal obstruction. Now management, first we will give corticosteroids to reduce the inflammation, subdiaphragmatic abdominal thrust maneuver. In case of any suffocation or choking, we will give this. This is called the subdiaphragmatic abdominal thrust maneuver. Okay, so by giving thrust or giving force on the abdomen, therefore the whatever the food has been blocked or whatever the, if there's any obstruction or any foreign body which is obstructed in the larynx, that can be removed, it will come out through the mouth. Then you have to establish the airway, provide oxygen to the patient, then ventilation. Patient who are not able to breathe properly on their own, so they require ventilation. Then emergency tracheostomy should be done and arytenoidectomy. Okay, so these are some of the management for laryngeal obstruction. Okay, so I hope this is clear. This is a very short topic, right? It is on laryngeal obstruction. So I hope this is clear. Thank you, class.